already. I'm pleased to host at the Frontline Club Dmytro Potekhin, who came from Ukraine and has, I think, unique insights about the situation there, and especially about the situation in the conflict region, because we hear news from Kiev, we hear European news, but really we need people who actually been to the area, and let alone been there, he's been kept captive actually by separatists. And before that accident that happening, he was very active in both journalists and activism. He has taught methods of peaceful resistance and actually took part in the preparations for the, I almost said Rose Revolution, for the Orange Revolution in Ukraine. And then he got very interested in what was there, but Dmytro will tell us more about how he got there and what he saw. Please, we are really very interested in that. And then we will open the floor to the questions.
Thank you. I will tell you very briefly about there, and then I will prepare probably to have questions and answers. No, to tell the same old story, because actually I'm already tired of repeating it again and again, so it would be more interesting to tell you what you want to know. I'm a political analyst. My background is international relations. I studied international relations in Kiev and Budapest, and I'm also alumni of the Stanford Summer Program, the Center for Democracy Development and the Rule of Law. And sometimes various journals invite me to write columns for them, and sometimes ask to write something more deeper, and that was the case. A colleague of mine from a Canadian peace magazine asked me to write about the situation in Ukraine. And although the text did not have to be just about Donetsk, I realized that, you know, it would be not very serious to publish something about Ukraine now and not mention Donetsk. So I decided to go there, and I just took a ticket there. I got there by train, and I had ticket back home, back to Kiev, for the same day. So it did not have to be as lengthy stay there as it turned out to be there. So I found it was quite a peaceful city, at least from the first sight. It was kind of okay. The only thing which was strange, that there was almost nobody on the streets. They were basically empty. And so I traveled around the city making pictures, and I was arrested when I was going back to the railway station. It was about 6 p.m., August 7th, and for several hours I tried to explain that actually, you know, I was going to miss the train, so here is the ticket, so why are you keeping me here? But they were very serious and tried to explain that actually I was lucky that they did not beat me or kill me, so. But then I stayed overnight in the same hotel where I was arrested. Actually, I made a picture of the hotel I used to stay with a girlfriend several years ago, and I did not notice the block posts inside the hotel. Because usually they had several block posts in the city, like with all the specs and other stuff, but in this case they were inside and they couldn't see them. And they came out asking what I was doing, asking to show them the mobile phone, students, and of course when they saw my Kiev registration, they said, they put a sack on my head, handcuffs, and that's it. And then one interrogation, next day several more interrogations, and then I was brought to a place which is called Izolyatsiya. It's a former plant in one of the districts of Donetsk.
I think you see it's the map for you.
This is the address. It's funny. There are several very really funny things about it, because the street is called Svetlava Puti. Well, this is the territory of this plant. This is a former plant of like insulation materials, I don't know in English, like stiklovata. So again, when I hear like this way of calling this kind of service, I got the feeling. I mean, I'm not sure that was the source of that name, but this was definitely something reminiscent of that language. So this whole territory, this is the territory of this clan. This is this ulica Svetlava Puti. I was kept in several places there. This is the main entrance, the main gate. This is the administrative building. It's like three-story small administrative building, like any Soviet plant had something like that. And this is, I guess, five store and one more. And there was so-called casa in this administrative building, which is a small room just, you know, for cantons and money. So it had gates on the doors, and we were kept for several first days in that place. And then I was brought to this hangar, and there is inside, there is kind of klobovka, you know, for some propaganda stuff with shelves, like five level of shelves, quite small, no windows, problems with oxygen. And I was sent to the place twice. The first time there were nine other people, and more mainly kind of drug addicts, the whole Sami people too. And first time I was kept there for 3 days, and it was quite tough. Because none of these rooms, and none of these rooms were ready, you know, to keep people there. In contrary to ordinary jail, where you can have toilet and water right there. So, this was different, and this could easily become a way of torture.
So that's a kind of prison, essentially.
It
was,
yeah, they
makeshift prison.
Yeah, they and some people from the administration, they were definitely professionals, but most of the guards, they were just kind of volunteers. And as far as I know, they were not paid, so they were inclined to stealing money, money, mobile phones, cars, etc. So that's basically all the common in there, I guess. And also metal, because we could hear old metal removed from the plant almost all the time. So that's how they survived, I guess, economically. And also new cars. Because closer to the end of the can you hear me? Discussing all this stuff, and we could hear shootings. And I said, I mean, guys, I mean, this is, don't you think it's strange? I mean, I'm not involved in this story. I was not organizer of this year on my dance. Okay, I was helping journalists, actually. I was fixing for Al Jazeera in America. And one of the other guys, like deputy minister of MGBA, I guess his position was MGBA, Министерство государственной безопасности. То есть МДР, Народной Донецкой Республики. And he, when he heard Al Jazeera, he asked, Al Jazeera? Like, are you recognizing you work for Al Jazeera? Yes. And two other guys also during the interrogation. Ah, Al Jazeera. But do you know that Al Jazeera is recognized a terrorist organization by the DNR? I said, guys, are you sure Al Jazeera, not Al Qaeda? and they
made no answer.
No, they started smiling too, because I mean that was I don't know. I mean for them it was quite a surprise too that actually you know there is also Al Jazeera, you know, not Al Qaeda. I don't know. But that was that was quite a, I mean, not the only paradox of that situation. And when they started accusing me of, you know, organizing non-violent Orange Revolution, I said, guys, I mean, what, I mean, did you have any idea that actually probably that was something good, you know? And what is going on now is really bad, you know? Anyway, it was without bloodshed in 2004. And at that point, they stopped like trying to develop this line
of interrogation.
But they asked, okay, like, have you been to the United States? I said, yes. How many times did you have a chance to go abroad? I said, less than I would like to go, but then, yes, I've been there lots of times, and Stanford and other places, what was the reason for your visit? Like, conference? Did you notice any attempts to establish contact with you? Well, I said, you know, I noticed lots of such attempts. Moreover, I can say I tried to do such attempts, you know, to establish contact.
This is called networking.
This is called conference, you know. I mean, you go there to establish contacts. That's the point. And these two guys who were interrogating this issue, they also. No, they could not smile, but I mean, that was really kind of anecdotic situation. You know? Then they showed me, both of them locals from Donetsk, and later when I released, I met them in the building, another building of the SNGB. When I was kind of officially released already, but I still had to be taken out of that place. And I met those two guys, and they told me their stories and how they became kind of, you know, part of the MGB. But that's a separate interesting issue. But to give you an idea of like how that whole story is constructed, one of the guys who was jailed and spent some time in the same casa with me when I was brought. So that's when I was released, he was my guarding me with his machine gun. Young guy, a local guy too. So, and basically, you had three ways out of that whole story. Like, start cooperating with them, pay bribe and get out, or stay there. So, my case, I guess about 10 other people were released. That was the first time where kind of you released through some kind of procedure, because they even did not accuse me or other people of anything. They did not have any kind of procedure. Yeah, there's no court system, okay?
Yes.
when we were discussing kind of my release, because that was not final interrogation, they just said, you know, it was a mistake, and we have nothing against you, actually. But we hope that you would cover it objectively and possibly. I will not lie about it. But they just don't understand that the things they are doing it's unacceptable. They are living in their own kind of closed world of myths and Russian propaganda. The lady head of this investigation department of this NKB, she had Russian flag on her wall. So, and the flag, small flag of this Donetsk on her table. So ideologically they are kind of pro-Russian, neo-Soviet, chauvinist and nationalist in general. So all those stories about Dugin and his influence, that's very true.
That's true.
Yeah, definitely. They are ideologically indoctrinated, and they believe in what they are doing, and it doesn't mean that they don't have kind of some economic interest, but those implementation of those interests by stealing support, mobile phones, cars, used cars from the detained or new cars from car salons. This type of economy is kind of backed by their worldviews. We have a number of discussions with these people, not only those who interrogated me, but with those who were kept in the same cells with me, because almost all of them were locals. All of them were Donetsk people, and some of them were quite sober on what was going on, but most of them, they still, you know, several days in the detention, they could say something like, but you know, it's just a mistake of the system. In principle, they were at least there in the cell, but most of them have to bear in mind that actually, you know, they could assume that there was somebody sitting, like, listening. Because paranoia is also this kind of very widespread thing about them, and basically this is something driving all those ideas about Kiev and the West, and including, you know, their attempt to accuse me of being a spy, etc. So, but most of these people, they could say, well, but those from Kiev, they will come and kill us, or. That, you know, why are you surprised, Dima, that you are taken here?
You're talking about the prisoners, aren't
you? Yeah, prisoners, that's the point. That actually
they're supporting the system.
I mean, I don't claim that all of the people in Donetsk support the system, because there are other surveys.
What percent would you say?
I know. And this is, there was definitely kind of, you know, selection of the people for the focus group that I had in cell, but I'm not
so
sure
that,
I don't think that this was a representative sample of the people in the Donetsk, of course. So I would not claim this is kind of sound psychological survey.
You cannot generalize to the population.
No, of course. But what I mean is that their logic of those people detained, they worked the way which would actually support the whole system, and not only with their ideas, but the ways they were getting out of the cell. Like they were either paying bribes and actually funding the system, because they did not have wages. At least in late September, I heard that they started receiving something, but not all of them, and not huge money. So actually, prisoned here, they were asking, you know, for a leave, they were suggesting bribes, and or joining the ranks of the system and actually again reinstalling the system just by themselves. And, yeah. Personally, some of them were quite okay, but when it came to politics or this or their role, of course, definitely they were working for the system.
We need to open this interesting conversation we're having to our audience, and ask if you have any further questions.
I'd be curious to hear. My main question is, like, is the rest of Ukraine, people in Ukraine, here in Lviv, having the, like, I would say, correct, or like, have you seen the situation with people in Donetsk before when you came there, being there detained? Did it give you some kind of new understanding of who are those people and why they are doing this? Do you think there's some kind of gap in understanding between, I don't know, West and East Ukraine?
In this case, definitely yes. I mean, at least those people fighting they're now Soviets. You know, once I was asked if it is kind of ethnic conflict, and I said, you know, in a way, yes, but if we believe that, you know, those guys, they are neo Soviets, and this is kind of new old ethnic group, like, okay, Soviet, Sovietsky Narod. So actually, this is the place on the planet where I saw the Sovietsky Narod as a group of people, and that's why they're still there, and that's why they're fighting there, because they, I guess they believe what they're doing, unfortunately.
So it wasn't new for you to understand this, or did they like you?
No, I had that assumption.
It was a certain... Did it surprise you?
No, that was just, you know, something like I saw it myself, and I saw the colors of that, and how seriously deep and actually in a way amazing it is, and it's, you know, terrible reality. That's what I saw. As a political analyst, I definitely had assumptions about that, and I mean, I was not going to stay there long, you know, just for several hours. And I warned some of my friends that I was going there, and I asked them to start campaign if I went back today. So I mean, I was pretty sober about what was going on there. I was surprised when I saw. No people on the streets. I mean, that was, and I was surprised actually that I was not arrested immediately or killed, you know, in a shooting. That I saw several places where buildings were damaged by bombings, I guess, and that was kind of okay for a war, okay? Because I mean, Ukrainian media, they are showing terrible war, and basically that's it, a terrible war. But I mean, to see these places and how they're living and surviving during this kind of war, this was something. And how that war is constructed from within, that was interesting. It was interesting to see clashes between the different groups within the MDF, for instance, because they were violent clashes. They were clashes with Zenitka. You know, like one group called Aplot could come to this our base where I was kept, and start negotiation on giving back several of their people arrested by MGB with several очередей Зенитки, да? Убежали Зенитка, и несколько очередей по зданию, после этого начало переговоров о чем-то. So that was surprise. But several other things we discussed with people in the south. Because as I mentioned, some of the fighters of DNR, they were also kept in this kind of prison for drinking, not following orders, for some other things. So that was interesting. Yes.
May I? You mentioned Russian propaganda. Do you think that Kiev has a sound policy in wanting to talk here? No. Anyway, do you think there is any solution to Russian propaganda? In other words, is Kiev doing anything against further attempts to brainwash that and maybe the rest of the population, Russian-speaking population in the country? So is it, or do you have any recommendations towards the effect? How to deal with propaganda and like formation of more and more people into neo-Soviets?
Well, I would say education, but we're not only of the people in those territories, but education of Ukrainians too, by the way. Because I feel that lots of people, they have a very basic idea about how nonviolent resistance works, and actually, by the way, we usually don't call it peaceful resistance. This was probably one of the mistakes of the Euromaidan, by the way, that although the protesters were beaten regularly in Kiev, those people from the stage, they kept calling for peaceful action. And actually, nonviolent action is not a type of peace, it's a type of conflict. And you need to be very sober about actually planning your campaign so that it would undermine the regime. And this is not the way to establish peace in the regime. This is, lots of people in Ukraine, they believe that what I'm doing and what other people are doing, it's kind of pacifism. That's not. This is the way when you can actually undermine sources of power for government. And the thing is that it is more efficient than violent and military. There is a very interesting study by two American researchers. They took all the key conflict of the last 100 years. And they analyzed the efficiency of methods used to fight those conflicts. And they found out that about a quarter of all those conflicts were won using military methods. And as many as half of the conflicts were won using nonviolent methods. There's a study called Why Civil Resistant Wars, which is published in English now, as a book, but there's also an article in the International Security Journal, which is free and available online. So this is, if we believe that Ukraine somehow is also part of the world and some tendency, like worldwide trends also actual for Ukraine, then I would say that nonviolent resistance must be used in Ukraine too, and it will be more efficient in Ukraine too. And by the way, in 2004 we successfully stopped in Polish in that attempt to usurp power in Ukraine without violence. And that's what actually we failed, unfortunately, in 2014. So 10 years later, fortunately, my country showed it lost the capacity to solve political problems nonviolently. And which means, by the way, that now, to be as successful as Georgia, for instance, in reforms, we need to be much more serious, even in 2005. And unfortunately, I'm not sure that now we are efficient enough introducing reforms and opening the society.
I'm Noir. There are, I heard some views, opinions that because of media is tired covering Ukrainian issue, maybe Russians will use that chance, and near the winter they will spread their military actions more. And I mean, they will start big war. How do you assess these opinions? Is it possible? What do you think?
Well, theoretically it's possible. Practically, I'm sure it is not possible. The thing is that, well, officially Moscow is denying that they are doing that, okay? And you know that right today there is a meeting in Italy and Putin said they are not claiming Ukrainian territory again and again, which means that they still can support those guys in unofficially. But that support is not efficient, and that's what I saw from inside Donetsk, because the fighters there, they were demoralized, they were not paid, they were given quite the same food, by the way, that we were given in the prison. Probably they were also receiving like salads and fresh food. Yes, we were just given quite the same, but 2 or 3 days old. And moreover, you know, when I announced the hunger strike, some people became angry with that, but some people started, you know, to shake hands. I mean, the guards, those guys in the MGB, and that was a surprise for me too. Of course, you know, that's something I learned, that actually, you know, all those things that we train people about,
they actually work.
Yeah, so what a surprise, it actually works, yes. And when I started talking to that guy who actually was a guard, and he opened, you know, that door in the cell, and he explained that actually they are given quite the same other shit, okay, to eat. So, but contrary to me, for instance, they could not protest because they are kind of the fighters here, you know, they came here not to have tasty, delicious food, they came, you know, to fight. But I could, you know, talk and, you know, discuss with them the quality of food, which made them, of course, some of them not very happy. But in a way supporting us, and that was strange for me, because usually what I would expect from people would be the famous syndrome, the Helsinki syndrome, and but in my case it was the opposite. I could see that those guys actually, they were kind of, you know, trying to show some sign of support to us, not on the other side. I mean, apart from those guys who just joined the guards, but probably also because they started their careers in this MGB from the cells too, probably that's made them more cooperative. And for instance, they could, once I had Grusha, there. Yeah, and one of the guards he gave us, me and another guy, but he tried to do that so that other guards could not see that. So, and such strange things. But so they could see we are kind of human beings, okay? And for the fighters, that was not a problem to beat us. But for the administration of the jail, for instance, that was, at least at the later stages of the imprisonment, that was kind of strange things, I would say. At least it did not happen. And they actually, because they're indoctrinated, they had very strange ideas about the actual situation on the ground, for instance, because 1 month ago, you could hear from them something like, okay, Mariupol is surrounded, and now we announced our demands to the Ukrainian side, and etc., etc. So they are very unrealistic about their military capacity to fight the war. Okay? And they're definitely expecting more from Putin than he can officially give. So, and those expectations, they make people disappointed and frustrated, yes. And that's why they definitely get some weapons, that's all. Okay, that's true. They get some advice from the Russian militaries. Okay. And one of the guys, well, once I was interrogated by an FSB officer. At least he was presented to me as an FSB officer. But the deputy minister of MGB, who was originally from Kiev, as I got, and just left the city after the Euromaidan. He, in the second week of my detention, I saw him with Russian insignia on his uniform. So they were, I mean, if not initially Russian, that in the process they became part of the Russian military. Or at least they felt, they're feeling themselves this way. And I guess that now it's a problem for Putin too, because officially he is kind of denying the involvement, okay? But in the ground, that's the fact, and lots of people, and not just me, saw that, you know? So, and given all the like, kind of semi-official Russian involvement, they can't provide, they can't start this war. I mean, they were stupid to start the occupation and annexation of the Crimea, and they were stupid to support this operation in eastern Ukraine, but they don't have capacity, both political and I'm not a military expert, so I don't know whether they have military capacity to conduct that war, but politically they are in a deadlock. And today's meeting in Italy testified to that assumption once again. So that's, and there is whole, you know, there's big kind of discussion among experts whether Russia is an expanding empire or a shrinking empire. And now with more and more experts, they agree that actually Russia is shrinking. It is trying to sell itself to her voters and citizens as a big neo-imperial state, but actually it cannot provide that status technically. You know, and I guess that's one of the reasons why Putin annexed Crimea. That actually he realized that when Yanukovych was ousted, that he's gonna lose. Probably the only sign, the last sign of that Russian semi-greatness, because he can't provide quality of life to Russians, he can't provide rule of law, he can't provide jobs, investments, etc. And now even those guys living quite good lives, they also lacking elements of the
because of sanctions,
right. So, and that's why he had to kind of had, within his concept of greatness, he had to occupy Crimea, and that's what is giving to Russians and to these people in Donetsk that wrong, very wrong feeling that actually Russia is great power, able to project its power, but actually it's based on propaganda, on misconceptions of international relations and Russian power and role in the world. And for some time it can work, and it can work to keep some people fighting, okay? But just for some time. And at the end, my assumption is that the end of this greatness, it will also be linked to the Ukrainian story, because sooner or later it will become obvious that Russia cannot provide those territories economically. And I think that it will happen sooner or later, but I think that we can make sure that it will happen sooner.
Yes.
And that's why I think, despite of the changes on the oil prices, now it would be important to also make sure that for Ukrainian companies buying Russian oil and gas, it would not be feasible to buy from Russia. And that's why I think that the Ukrainian occupation tax is needed in Ukraine. And I will be happy if such a tax will be introduced by the European Union too. So,
Abkhazia and Ossetia is a good example for the other opinion that Russia could support such kind of region for quite a long time and keep this conflict much painful and much painful for the country like it.
Yeah, you can also mention Transnistria. Mm-hmm. I know. The thing is that, by the way, Putin today mentioned Transnistria. He said we don't want to arrange Transnistria in Donetsk, which can be another lie, of course. But the thing is that this is another reason to actually make sure that Russia will not have the chance to sustain itself due to oil prices and gas prices. And that's why, again, that tax is needed. And it's very simple. It's just everybody who buys energy resources from Russia would pay money for diversification of energy sources, for green energy, for energy efficiency, and yes, would buy energy from different countries, not from Russia. That's why it is needed to solve not only the problems with the Crimea, with Donetsk, but also with Southeast Asia and Abkhazia. I think that the Georgians would could and still can help
do this. Lobby for such things, right? Can you share with us like the inside opinions about Georgia's support in this time? So are the people and government think that Georgia is adequate of the situation? I mean the government.
You mean support
the new
Ukraine?
Government, yes, like the new government. Because here in Georgia there are a lot of discussion. Can we be more helpful, more pro-Ukrainian, or vice versa, more calm? And so, what about you? How you feel this from the Kiev, from the Ukraine?
Well, myself, I feel yes, Georgian support me a lot. Yes, I'm happy to be here. So, officially, I don't know. I mean, I'm not. And I met with press secretary of Poroshenko when I was out, and I know that some people from the administration, they are reading my posts and publications, but I'm not a part of the Ukrainian administration. During the interrogation by the FSB officer, by the way, I was asked why the defense minister should ask about. And if I am surprised with that, I said, yeah, I mean, I'm surprised because I'm not a military, I'm not a spy, I'm not working for the Ukrainian administration. And he went like, okay, who did you expect to ask about your destiny? I would expect human rights activists ask about me. And that's basically was also the fact that was true. I know that Freedom House was involved in the attempts to release me, so it did not happen just because of my hunger strike, just to make it clear. So if nonviolent resistance works, but
it is
great when also other nonviolent means are also taken. So Ukrainian administration, I think it must be happy that it has advisors from Georgia. I'm not sure if Georgian advisors are happy with the pace of the reforms in Ukraine. I'm not happy. Okay. I know that lots of new nice papers were passed by the Ukrainian parliament recently, but I know that Ukrainians, they are very good at surviving any government since Soviet times. Be it a good government or bad government, but we kind of, professionally hiding from them. So I'm not sure that these papers will influence seriously the situation in the country. Besides, I was kind of advising non-officially to the government after the Orange Revolution, because they invited me to meet and to talk, but it could not work. It was obvious from the very beginning when you invited to meet with Vice Prime Minister on European integration he's calling to invite you, and then you wait half an hour to get the clearance in the old Soviet security system of the Cabinet of Ministers.
Yes.
And so all the, at the top you can get the best people, you can get... Yeah, you can get nice laws, but it will not be enough. I'm afraid that that will of the Georgian successful reformers to help Ukraine will get into the same trouble. They can give brilliant advice, but they will end up nowhere. I know that one of the best, and in terms of ideas, the best Ukrainian reformer now is a Georgian, okay?
You mean Vendukin?
Yes. I mean, I...
So he isn't in opposition right now, so
I guess there are some reasons for that. And I guess... I know a friend of mine who used to be Minister of Economic Development in this government, he resigned when I was on my trip to Donetsk, so I did not have a chance to talk to him yet, but as far as I know from his comments, it's ungovernable, it's just, you can't run an old Soviet machine with new methods. I mean, that was an attempt to kind of, to fix a plane while it was flying. So what I advised was actually to announce a technical default after Yanukovych was ousted. Mm-hmm. I said, guys, let's be realistic.
Default on all foreign and internal debts, you mean?
Well, actually, default of the attempts to kind of refurbish the Soviet Ukrainian state system. And to kind of outsource state services. And was basically kind of going in now. Officially, politically, it's not easy, I understand. But technically, for at least people who are trying to change the situation, it would be necessary, I guess, to approach the system with this type of thinking. Because, for instance, on the day of inauguration of Poroshenko, the Prime Minister, Yatsenyuk, giving a speech in the Parliament, I guess, he said that, we have managed to reanimate Ukraine. And I think that this is wrong way of thinking and talking about this, because, its social organization is not a human being. Which means that actually some types of organizations, including sometimes states, they can be changed or even announced dead, contrary to persons. Okay? Because we know that it's bad that somebody is dead. necessarily bad when some old, for instance, Soviet state is dead. Okay? So, and I think that there is still lacking of that understanding of how to think about things. And I would say that probably Bindukiza, whom I don't know personally, but he understands more about such things than current our official thinking, unfortunately. But fortunately, we have such Ukrainian Georgian reformer as Donetsk. And I hope that his ideas will be listened to by my government more seriously than attentive.
Actually, yeah, why don't we give her a possibility, and you motion to me when you feel like you've exhausted our time.
I'm Moshe from Armenia. I have three questions at once. I would like to know how you see the solution of this conflict, Ukrainian and Russian. And can you say that this war was inevitable?
And this world war?
Inevitable. And what will be the future of customs union?
I have one question concerning the customs union.
So I ask you now?
Frankly, I don't know nothing about the customs union. I don't believe in it, and I will. I think that it is hopeless. It makes no sense. And I believe that the way out of the conflict with Russia is to make sure that Russia finally has no resources to implement its policies. This war was inevitable, as well as wars with Georgia. Because, again, the only way for Putin to get legitimacy, very wrong legitimacy, okay, but like public support, is to have a war, to have an outside enemy. And actually, Russia, it is too small and too weak to have serious enemies. And so, but to provide those stories and to provide Russians with those news and something showing to them that actually there are enemies around Russia. Moscow is, Kremlin is starting those wars again and again. So they can't survive without wars. That's why this Russian regime, it must be removed, and that's why the European Union, Ukraine, Georgia, and others, they would better help this economic trend with prices on oil and gas, and help this Russian regime die by introduction of a tax which would make it unfeasible for economic players in our countries to buy energy sources from Russia. I'm not sure if I answered the question.
It means that, for example, Armenia, which recently signed the agreement about custom union, will overcome these economical and official deadlock, which is now in Armenia, right?
I don't know what will happen in this case, but I hope that most of the providers of economic support to Russia, I mean those who are buying Russian energy sources, will stop doing that. End of Russia in this form that it exists now, the neo-imperialist Russia, this is just an issue of time. Because, I mean, they can survive in such, in the 20th century, such things, they cannot exist. I don't think that there is end of history, and my colleague Frank Pupian and others, they are right in the principle that actually, in terms of type of social organization, yes, there is end of history, but I guess that such people as Putin and such people as fighters in Donetsk, they don't want end of history, and they're trying to go back, you know, and to have some more fun before it's over. But it will be over anyway.
So not like.
So we just can help. Yes, we can help Russians end the rule of Putin or any other new imperialist. And the bad news is that, as we learned in the recent several days, even the leaders of the Russian opposition, they are not as liberal as we would like them to be. And, but again, it's not a surprise to me, because I had some conversation with Navalny, for instance, several years ago, so I was quite critical about him personally. But there are some other people, and again, it's not about some individuality, okay? It's not about some personality. It's about, you know, the readiness of the people to bring down their regimes and the deal in non-violently, because otherwise you can get even worse rulers. That's...
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. If there's possibility that will we know your email, and if there are any further questions from our journalism students or journalism colleagues, would you mind?
I can, yes, I can write my email somewhere here. There is, yes.
So that there's a continuation of professional ties between
us.
Georgian and Armenian journalists and yourself.
Was welcome together with my friends from Maidan. We were received at the parliament, Georgia, and people were applauding. And now I'm keeping game. Now it's even better. I can see the city, lots of nice places, and my friends from the economic policy research center. They are visiting me here, and they take care of me, and I'm happy with them. And would like to thank Nino personally.
And I guess our food is a little better than what you were.
Definitely, not the best. No.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much.
Your pleasure.